Today we are starting an introduction to the finite element method as we try to learn about computer modeling and simulation to help us with the machine design of different components. This is the common practice in the contemporary workplace where we have these tools handy and available. And definitely, as you're going to see and learn, it's very enjoyable and it provides significant amount of information that we may not be able to get without using these tools. The purpose of this portion of the course is that many of you are expected to have experience with these tools as you start your careers. And we want to make sure to give you some background. So you are not using any of the commercial software packages and dealing with it just as a black box, but you can really understand more about what's happening behind it, how these methods work, equip you with better understanding of the vocabulary and terminology that is being used. So when you're making decision, you understand exactly, or you better understand what you are doing. So I have a disclaimer here. By no means, this is a course in finite elements. I'll be offering a graduate course in finite element this coming spring, which is the ME514. For anyone that is interested to learn more about the method, you can join us in the spring. But this is gonna be a very quick kind of an overview, introduction to the terminology, and we're going to focus on a very simple concept because I would like you to be able to relate what we can do by hand calculations for simple problem to what a software package will do for you. And you will see that the homework assignments moving forward are tailored in this direction. So in a way, you're going to be solving the same problem by hand using the traditional method that you have learned, like in solid mechanics. You're gonna solve it also doing hand calculations using the finite element method, as well as comparing your answer to what you can do in using a software package like ANSYS Workbench, which is what we're gonna be using in this class. With that being said, I'm gonna start going through my lecture notes, which are posted on Canvas as well. And here is a list of our learning objectives here. We wanna learn in general about the finite element method. Some of the terminology that we're gonna learn about would be degrees of freedom, element stiffness equations, global stiffness equations. We're gonna review this vocabulary. We're gonna take examples and look at some of the advantage and disadvantages of the finite element method. A simple description of the finite element method, referred to it as FEM, F-E-M. It's a method of finding a numerical solution for field problems. We are going to use it primarily to solve structured problems to serve our needs in machine design, but finite element method is also used in other fields like electromagnetics, like fluid dynamics, you name it. So there are many areas that can take advantage of this numerical solution when the analytical solution is not easy to find. So pretty much everything we've been doing so far, we have these equations that are analytical or provide an analytical solution to a problem that has a mathematical idealization or formulation. When it's difficult to find this closed form analytical solution, we start seeking this numerical method. Of course, another method where we solve problem would be an experimental method, where we take something to the lab and test it and find that solution. How does the finite element method work? It does simply cuts a structure into multiple smaller pieces. We call them elements or discrete pieces of the structure. This process is known as discretization. Discretization. I take a continuous system and I break it into a discrete system. Now, this may involve some approximation, and yes, approximation is inherently within this numerical method, namely the finite element method. Now, this finite element or piece element or piece in the finite element method is a discrete piece of that structured system. And again, the structured system is continuous. The finite element then connects the elements at nodes. Connect the elements at nodes. Of course, these pieces need to stay connected together because it's one continuous structure. This process of breaking it into elements and then connect them at nodes allow us to put together a set of simultaneous algebraic equations that when we solve, we do have a solution for the problem. So I mentioned nodes, the elements are connected at nodes. So these nodes are simply points that are defined at a specific point in a structure where the elements join. So these discrete pieces that are adjacent to each other would join each other at points that we call them nodes. And you can think of nodes as drops of glues or joints that hold the pins that hold the elements together. So these adjacent elements that are connected at these nodes also share the behavior, which is in case of a structure problem, would be the displacement U or the degrees of freedom at the connecting nodes, at the connecting node. And you can see here, I am kind of using the color code, green for nodes, blue for elements. And we're gonna also introduce or make sure you understand what is meant here by degrees of freedom in a second. What results from breaking or discretizing the structure into elements and nodes is what we refer to as a mesh. And a mesh in the finite element method is constructed of the elements that are within the structure system, which we are going to make of a part or a geometry connected at nodes. So again, the mesh is basically comprised of these elements connected together at nodes. I want to show here two different structure problems that requires a mesh. So you look here, if I want to come up with a mesh, I have the top truss structure and I have the bottom engine block. If you look at them, there is significant difference between the two in terms of thinking about how do I break this into discrete or smaller pieces. The structure at the top is inherently made of an assemblage of pieces, which makes the finite element mesh visually apparent. You see here, these members are already connecting at joints or points, and they are inherently an assemblage of these little pieces. So kind of make, if I want to break this into pieces, you kind of know you already have like a grid that you can simply use. However, the engine block at the bottom is a continuous system that is not physically apparent on how we're going to break it into smaller pieces. If every one of us is going to break this, I would imagine that we can have 18 different solutions here to this way of how we're going to break it. Versus the top structure, we're probably going to agree on some sort of, or have an agreement on a mesh that most of us are probably going to be using. If I take an example of a physically apparent structure that is made of an assemblage, I'm going to take this simple truss example. So if you look at the truss shown here, it is made of 9 blue pieces that are connected together at 6 green joints. So this truss has 6 joints and 9 members. So this is an example of a physically apparent finite element method system. When I make a mesh, this mesh is also going to be compromised out of 6 nodes, the green, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 9 elements, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. In order to solve a structure problem and using the finite element method, we need boundary condition. We need to make sure that the structure does not allow for rigid motion because we're solving a statics problem. So you see here, I have a pin support and roller support. If I'm working in 2D, this structure should go nowhere. It is constrained to translation in the X, translation in the Y, as well as rotation in plane. And these are the only 3 degrees of freedom for a 2D structure. Also, there must be an effect that causes this structure to deform, which in this case would be the load P. As I apply the load P at node 5, all these elements are gonna start displacing. If I know or can calculate the displacement of each of the green joints, I can find the displaced state of the structure. And this is what I'm gonna show you in the next slide. And I'm also gonna show how I did it using the finite element package. So a first step after having a geometry, I am able to create a mesh. So what you're looking at here, you're seeing kind of the geometry, but this is actually a mesh that is comprised of 9 elements and 6 joints. It has boundary condition expressed here by this blue symbol C and the yellow symbol A, where I'm fixing it at the left support and at the right support. It also have an effect. In this case, I have a force of 1000 Newton applied downward of the truss. This is showing the original state of the truss. If only I can find the displacement of each of these joints, I can sketch a displaced state of the structure. Each of these elements, being a truss member, is expected either to elongate or compress. So if I can know the start point and end point, I can connect these two points by a line, which is going to show the displaced state of the member. So again, if I can solve for displacements at node 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, I'm going to get this displaced state of the structure, which we can see here as a result of the 1000 Newton applied at node number 5. I was pulling node 5 downwards. Please note that node 3 right here, node 3, did not go anywhere because this has the pin support. Node 6 to the right was on a roller. So it was allowed to translate in the X direction, but not to move in the Y direction. So you can see that joint 3 and joint 6 still remained on the same horizontal line, but joint 5 being free moved downwards. Joint 4 that I'm pointing at right here also moved downwards. It is clear that joint five also moved some to the left as the member here, element 9, got elongated. Now, I can also show you that in an animation. So again, this is a sample of workbench that you are going to be using in this class. And here I show you how, as I apply the loads, I can use computer modeling or simulation, the finite element method, to simply find the display state. And of course, we can generate this video or this animation to look at how the structure is going to perform to make sure we have a good model that is capturing the behavior of the structure. So this is the displaced state of the structure. I can also look at the stresses in the members. So we can see, and you know, this are should be two force members, and we should get the same stress to the member. But you can see the ones that have the blue, these are in compression, and the bottom cords are in tension, and the vertical and diagonal member for this problem are this. There are some of them that are in tension, some of them are in compression. All right. If I look again at this truss that is physically apparent, has a physically apparent mesh with 6 nodes, 9 elements, the members are axially loaded and the form in straight lines along their axis. Each joint gets 2 translational displacements as X and Y components. So I can represent the displacement of any node by 2 components in the X and in the Y. So this is how the displacement. So I can find the displaced state of node 4. And maybe node 4 is going to be down here. When these displacements are found, we can plot the displaced states. Now, since I have 6 green joints and each node or joint gets 2 translational displacements, I can say that this structure has 6 nodes times 2 displacements per node, a total of 12 degrees of freedom. But if you look carefully, node 3 is not going anywhere. Node 6 can only translate in 1 degree of freedom, namely in the X direction. So I see here 2 constraints at 3 and 1 constraint at 6. So I can say here that yes, I have 12 degrees of freedom, less 3 restraints or constraints. 12 minus 3 is gonna give me 9 degrees of freedom that are unrestrained. In other words, when I am solving this problem, I only needed to find 2, 2, 2, and 1 translational degrees of freedom or displacements, a total of 9. So I was solving the set of simultaneous equations for 9 unknowns only, even though I have 12 degrees of freedom. Of course, once we find these, we can also find the support reactions, and we can find the forces in the members as we are going to learn. Any questions so far? So that takes me next to definition of degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom that we refer to as DOF. I am sure this is not a new concept. You've seen that in Dynamics, ES204, and maybe you've seen it in other classes. In finite element method here, I would like to think of it as displacement components, and this may be translation or rotation, that are necessary to determine the displaced state of a structure. Each degree of freedom describes either a translation or a rotation. And I'm gonna show you more examples as we learn about elements. But the number of degrees of freedom is dictated by these translations and rotations that are needed to determine that display state of a structure. Next, I want to show you an example of structures that do not inherently have elements that are physically apparent or obvious. So here we are looking at continuous systems where the elements are not physically obvious. The first example here shows a beam. And yeah, it looks like a very simple structure. It's a continuum. So I'm not really showing the engine block, which does not have any pieces. This one, you may think of it as made of pieces, but beams are continuous. This is like a continuous beam. And we have all these different types of loads and supports, as you can see. So now when you look at this, how many elements do I need to break this into to get some accurate results? Yeah, some of you may think like, oh, I can have a node here, a node here, a node here, and a node here. So like four nodes and three elements. If you do that, you don't have any opportunity to apply these loads. We have some continuous loads that are linear. You may not get an accurate result if you simply use three nodes. So this is not physically apparent. Someone may break this into like 10 pieces, break this into 20 pieces, and break this into 5 pieces, for example. So every one of us can come up with their own mesh. What I'm showing right here is a plate, a rectangular plate. And I came up with a grid to make these green nodes and blue elements. But maybe someone can use triangular elements to create a mesh. So again, with this continuous system, the elements are not physically obvious, and every one of us can come up with a mesh. Thankfully, many of the commercial software packages, or most of them these days, come with an automatic mesh generator that can create a mesh for you for a continuous system, and it really counts on the computer power that we have these days in our computer systems. So even if you get thousands of elements, you still can have a solution within reasonable time, which definitely was not the case when I started using finite element methods in the late 80s, early 90s. I remember, recall that on one of the projects I was working on in 1996, I would start the simulation on Friday before I leave work, and it would continue to run until Monday. And sometimes if I didn't have enough confidence in the mesh or the model, I would have to pay a visit to the office on a Saturday morning to make sure that it is still running. So this is different these days. You still, some problems would require computer capabilities of a supercomputer, not just on a regular PC. But definitely the number of elements that we use to create a mesh would dictate the complexity of the problem and how much computer time is going to need to solve. So while it is so easy to create a very fine mesh with thousands or millions of elements for your problem, it is not cost effective. And you may be just simply overcomplicating your problem. So we do not want to use a very refined mesh. We definitely want to use a fine mesh to provide an accurate solution. But we do not want our mesh to be extremely fine when it is not needed. So this is something that requires some experience, and also there are some tools that we can use to be able to tell whether we do have an accurate solution or not. We call it whether our numerical solution is converging or not yet. So again, this is something that has to do with the accuracy of the numerical solution which the finite element method does utilize. In this course, we're gonna keep it simple, and we are gonna use simply the mesh that the automatic mesh generator of ANSYS Workbench is gonna provide us when we start using the computer model. Now, one of the important things about how this method works is that the finite element method has to enforce equilibrium of forces at nodes. So for example, if I look at the truss we looked at earlier and pick node one, where I have element 1, 2, 3, and 4 connected. So I have 1, 2, 3, and 4. These are the number of elements connected to node one. If I draw a free body diagram of this node one, it is seeing forces applied to it from element 1, element 2, element 3, and element 4. And the finite element method makes sure that these forces are in equilibrium. So we use equilibrium of forces around the nodes. So when I apply equilibrium here, the sum of these forces in the x direction must be 0. The sum of these forces in the y direction must also be equal to 0. So the elements, adjacent elements like 1, 2, 3, and 4, sharing one node, sharing the same displacement of that node, ensure that the structure remains continuous or connected. The forces being in equilibrium ensures that this joint is an equilibrium. So between continuity and equilibrium of forces, the finite element method works. I want to mention here that for a physical nodal displacement, each of them, like as the node displaces, there must correspond to that an action. This action is in structure is typically a force or a moment. So the action is a force and moment. The effect of this action is this displacement. Now, the action within the elements would be an element internal force. Some example of actions would be like internal forces as an axial force. Corresponding to an axial force, I expect axial displacement. An element force, like a shear force, as in beams, would correspond to that a transverse displacement. Also in beams and frames, we may have a bending moment as an action, and corresponds to that, we may get a transverse rotation, or should get a transverse rotation. In shaft, we may have twisting moments, correspond to that, a displacement would be an axial rotation. So if I am calculating these degrees of freedom or these displacements on my element, if I have an axial displacement, I do expect an axial force. If I have a transverse displacement, I do expect a shear force. If I have a transverse rotation, I'm expecting a bending moment. If I have an axial rotation, I'm expecting a twisting moment. And we should be able to rotate these effects or displacements to the action. We relate these together using what we call stiffness equations. Stiffness equations relate the effects to the actions. I'm going to give these displacements the symbol U, and these actions or forces the symbol F. And I can write a simple stiffness equation as U equals to some constant times F. And you may recall the spring equation where delta is equal to F times K, where K was the spring constant. And we called it also sometimes the stiffness of the spring. So we can write these stiffness equations to relate displacements to action. We can write it for a simple piece or an element where we call it element stiffness equations. We can also write it for the structure and we call it a global stiffness equations. So I'm gonna show here like relations among external forces, the action corresponding to nodal displacements U, which is the behavior or the effect, are linear algebraic equations for a linear elastic structure. And they, when I'm describing the behavior of the entire structure, we call these global stiffness equations. And I'm writing it here as F equal to K times U. Please note an uppercase F and uppercase K here. And this U that you see here is also using an uppercase U, even though it's using the same notation that we use for the elements. But this vector is just the same as this vector shown here. This equation is the element, represent the element stiffness equations in matrix form. And these are developed to relate element forces, lowercase f, to element degrees of freedom, lowercase u. The element stiffness equations are written first, and then they are used to develop the global stiffness equations, as we're going to see in an example. I fully understand that these maybe do not make sense right now, but they're going to make more sense when you start seeing an example. Again, I'm just trying to walk you quickly through the method, and then we're going to work an example where you're going to better understand what I'm referring to in these equations. Next, I would like to start looking at element stiffness equations. So if I look at a simple element, just a 1D element, that could be used to represent a spring or a bar. Spring or a bar. Now, this spring or a bar is only allowed to displace along the x-axis. That's why I call it a 1D element. So you see there is an x-axis here. Whether it's the spring or the bar, it only has two nodes, one and two. And each node can only displace along the x direction. So it only has one translational degree of freedom. So each of these may be represented by an element that has 2 degrees of freedom. Simply translational degrees of freedom along the x axis. Now, this spring element or bar element may be used to model a two-force member, such as a strut or a truss member. Of course, I have to be careful when I say truss member, because primarily we are only allowing for X translation. So when you take the truss of members connected like the ones we had, we get components and the X and Y. But locally, each member is only translating along its axis. So that's the main difference here. When I say we're going to work problems by hand, do hand calculations, we are going to limit that to using this 1D type of element. If you want to do more elements, you want to come to the graduate course this spring. This is like the truss element that I can use to work on a 2D in the X and Y, where now I'm showing the components, U1 and V1, U2 and V2, two components at each node. Still, this truss element is only allowed to, at the end, to elongate or shrink, but each translation, because it can move in anywhere in the X and Y direction, is best represented by 2 translational degrees of freedom at each node. So we end up having 2 nodes, but total 4 degrees of freedom per element. And please remember, for a truss, we only can allow for translation. We do not have any rotation because it is not expected to take any bending moments. I want also to show a beam element. So this is a 1D element in the XY plane. And because this is a beam, it can bend, and it can also, a general beam element or a plane element, can also elongate or compress. So you see we have at each node 3 degrees of freedom. We have a transverse force in the Y direction. We have an axial force in the X direction, and we have a rotation about the Z axis. an in-plane rotation. Likewise, we have the same at node 2. So I have 3 degrees of freedom per node. That gives us a total of six degrees of freedom per element. Now, this beam element have 6 degrees of freedom. When we are developing simple beam elements, we know that the beam is not going to be subjected to any axial forces. We may reduce these to only 2 degrees of freedom, 1 and 3, and 4 and 6, and say that we only have transverse and rotation. We do not have any axial effect and end up with 4 degrees of freedom. So having identified elements, the first step would be to develop element stiffness equations. So looking here at element stiffness equation, for the only element we're going to use in this class analytically, which is a 1D spring element. And this is an element that is very easy to understand, and we can use basic principles to develop the element stiffness equations, and we can see them for ourselves. So it has two nodes, one or two, or I and J, corresponding to two translational degrees of freedom. Here I'm calling them UI and UJ, in consistency with your textbook. We have an element nodal force at node I on element E. I call this element E, and it has a stiffness K sub E. So the stiffness of this spring is K sub E. So the element force on node I would be F I applied to element E, because I may have another adjacent element to the left that has a different name. So it will also have an FI, but if this element is called like V, it will be FIV. At the other node, node J, I have an internal force FJ applied to element E. And please note that everything is acting in the x, the positive x direction, the internal forces as well as the displacement. Now you recall that for springs or rods, we learned how to calculate a delta, the elongation, and we learned that in solid mechanics as PL over AE, where P is the force that this spring is going to be subject to, or this bar is subject to. Now, if I rewrite that in terms of P, imagine if I'm solving for P in terms of delta, I can write it as P equals EA over L times delta. Or if I simply replace this EA over L with a K, that would be the stiffness of the element. So in other words, this KE is equal to EA over L in case this was a bar element instead of a spring. Okay, next, if I look at this spring and I wanna write or solve for FI, the force here to the left. This force is simply equal to K, F is equal to K times delta. And the delta in the spring is gonna be equal to the difference of these two displacements. So it'll be UI minus UJ. And please, if you look carefully at FI, FI is acting in the positive X direction, so it's really compressing the spring. So when I do UI minus UJ, even both of them are moving in the X direction, I'm still calculating the UI minus UJ. UI greater than UJ, this would be a compression, right? So I would get a positive FI. So I have here FIE is equal to KE times the displacement, net displacement, which is UI minus UJ in the same direction as FI. If I expand that, I can write it as ke ui minus ke uj. Likewise, if I look at fje and try to evaluate it, I have this fje trying to pull the spring, so this is tension, would be equal to the elongation, which is times the stiffness. So the stiffness is ke, and the elongation in this case would be uj minus ur. So I get here fje is equal to ke times uj minus ui. Now, if I rewrite that, expand it, and rearrange, I will get here the minus ke ui plus ke uj. So what I have here is I have it rearranged so that ui is the first term, the quantity multiplied by ui, and uj is the second term. I can put this in matrix form by combining these element forces, combining, taking the k as a common factor, and writing a matrix for displacement as in ui and uj. So we're gonna end up with a matrix form with something that looks like this. FIE, FJE is equal to these stiffness components multiplied by the displacements ui and uj, the nodal displacements. This can be simplified as F equal to, this is a column matrix multiplied by a square matrix multiplied by a column matrix. This is 2 by 1, this is 2 by 2, and this is 2 by 1. The above are the element stiffness equations where F is the load vector, KE is the element stiffness matrix, and U is the displacement vector. So we call this the load vector. We call KE element stiffness matrix, and we call U displacement vector. When we discretize a structure into elements, we need to know the element stiffness equations, or rather the element stiffness matrices for every element in the structure. Because in knowing these, we're gonna assemble them together to come up with a global stiffness equation. Another example here, as I said, the simplified 2D plane beam element. If you look carefully at this, I reduce the degrees of freedom per node to 2. So we have a total of 4 degrees of freedom. So I can say that U, the displacement vector, is equal to Y1 theta 1, Y2 theta 2. So I have here a 4 by 1. The corresponding forces to each of these degrees of freedom would be a translational force corresponding to Y1 and Y2, and a bending moment corresponding to theta 1 and to theta 2. So I can write the force vector as V1, M1, V2, M2. So for a simple beam that's primarily in bending, we have 2 nodes, 2 degrees of freedom at each node. When I say in bending here, of course, there is still the transverse shear effect, but there is no compression of tension. So we have 2 degrees of freedom at each node, 4 degrees of freedom per element. And we can create the element stiffness equation for the above beam element. Basically, we want to find the relationship between F and U. So I can write F as equal to some stiffness matrix K times U. Please note that if this is a 4 by 1, this is a 4 by 1, I expect the element stiffness matrix to be a 4 by 4. So as I come up with a relationship for V1, M1, V2, M2, in terms of some coefficients times the degrees of freedom, I can put these together to come up with element stiffness equation for that beam element. Again, I'm not planning on you using this by hand in this class, but I just want to show you how we can expand on the simple example that had a stiffness matrix of only 2 by 2. Next, we want to start looking at global degrees of freedom for the entire structure. I'm going to refer to them as GDOF as relates to EDOF, which is element degrees of freedom. The global degrees of freedom, the displacement of the structure, these are basically the same quantities as those of the elements, but with different labels and different numbering scheme with one-to-one correspondence to ensure continuity. So we want to make sure that there is continuity. So I want to use the same degree of freedom for each and every element that is connected to that particular node. And I think this would be best described using this simple example that shows a structure made of two connected 1D spring elements. So we already learned and developed the stiffness, element stiffness equation of a spring element like the one I'm showing here. Now, this is a structure made of two of these springs that are connected together. So if I start, this is like my mesh, where I have my nodes in green and my elements in blue. So I have node one, node two, node three. I have element one that connects between node one and node two. Element two connects between node two and node three. Now, when I am looking at the whole structure, I am expected to see external forces applied to the structure. So I have here on node one, I have an external force F1, and please note that I'm using uppercase F. At node two, I have an external force F2. I'm using uppercase F. Node three, I have an applied force F3, and again, I'm using the uppercase. So this is a mesh showing the nodes, elements, and external forces applied on a structure. Now, this structure is discretized into two springs or two elements. These elements may be broken down. When I separate them, it's like when we did a free body diagram. So I'm drawing here a free body diagram of the elements. When I draw the free body diagram, I am showing the element forces, not the global or the external forces. These element forces, I am describing them by lowercase f as it applies on the node. So I have here f1 for node 1, comma 1. Now this subscript that comes after the comma is referring to the element 1. This element one has a spring stiffness K1, and it has a displacement U1 at node one. On node two, I have an element force F2 applied to element one. So after the comma, I get here, after the comma, I get one for element one. I have a nodal displacement at node two that is best described using U2. I do the same for the second spring at node two. I have an element force F2 applied to element two. At node three, I have a nodal force F3 applied to element two, and this is an element force. Please note the displacements. At node one, I have U1, at node two, I have U2, and at node two, it is the same U2 that is shown for element one is also there for element two. This is continuity. So we have here continuity. At node three, I have U3. So I can say that this U1, U2, and U3 are the same that are taking effect on the global structure. Now, if I want to ensure equilibrium at each node, the sum of these element forces must be equal to the external force. So I can say that the external force F1 must be equal to F11. Okay, if I come here at node 2, now this node 2 is shared between the two elements. Each of the element has an element force. So I can say the sum of these element forces must be equal to this external forces F2 to ensure the equilibrium at the joint. So in other words, when these are equal, these forces are applied to the elements. The equal and opposite is applied to the nodes. So if I write the equilibrium equation, then simply they will cancel each other and the node is going to be in equilibrium. So that's why I can write that F2 is equal to F22 plus, or F21 plus F22, which you're seeing here. And finally, F3 must also be equal to F32. So in this simple slide, I want to emphasize that we have continuity at node 2, continuity at node 2, because the same U2, element 1 is saying the same U2. And I'm showing equilibrium of the joints because the opposites of the elements or forces are acting on the node to make sure that the node is in equilibrium. Any question? Okay, let's keep going then. Now, we can write the equations from each element, as we've learned, in matrix form. So I can write element stiffness equations for element 1. And by the way, this is exactly what we did put together for a spring element. And I'm using the element forces. So I have here F11, F21, U1, and U2. I'm going to do the same for element 2. So I can write here F22, F32, and I have here my stiffness. Please note that the spring constant for spring 2 is different than spring 1. So that's why I have here K1, I have here K2. Please note that it is positive K1, or K2, minus K2, minus K2, K2. Where did I get this from? These are the ones that we just derived right here. So positive K, minus K, minus K, and a positive K. These are the same ones that I'm using here. I'm applying it twice, once for element 1 and second time for element 2. Now I'm going to use the equilibrium equations, equilibrium of the node equations, to write or assemble my global stiffness equations in matrix form. So if you look at this, I already have an expression for F11. So I can write that in matrix form. Please note the displacement vector here and the displacement vector here. This very same U1 and very same U2 and very same U3 are going to be used to express the global degrees of freedom. So I have U1, U2, and U3. The force vector for the entire structure is going to be made out of the external forces at node 1, 2, and 3, namely F1, F2, and F3. So I have here F1, F2, and F3. Now I already have a solution for F1 because F1 is equal to F11. So if I copy this, I have K1 minus K1, K1 times U1 minus K1 times U2. So I get this from my first element stiffness equation. For F2, I really have two terms, F21 and F22. So I'm going to take this plus this. And when you do that, you will note that I have a K1 U1, which comes here K1 U1. Then I have a K, I'm sorry, there was a, there is a missing negative sign here. I'm going to fix that. So there should be a negative sign right here. That looks better. So minus K1. And then I have here a K1 U2. I got a K1 U2. Then I add to that F22. So I have here F22 that has a K2 times U2. So I have got a plus. And you please note that this goes to the second column because it is multiplied by U2. So K2, so I have here, I ended up with a coefficient here or a component of K1 plus K2. And then I have a minus K2 U3, it goes in the third column, so it gets multiplied by U3. And finally, I have F3, which has nothing function of U1, so that's why I get my zero. And then I have a minus K2 U2, comes here in the second column, minus K2 U2. And then I have a plus K2 U3 that comes here. I would like to point out that the element stiffness matrix here, this is a square matrix that is symmetric around the diagonal. The diagonal always have positive components, and you see the symmetry. This is also true for the global stiffness matrix. So these equations are known as global stiffness equations, or GSE. They may be described simply as F equal to Kg times U, where Kg is the global stiffness matrix. This global stiffness matrix is also a square matrix that has a diagonal that is always going to be positive, that is symmetric about the diagonal. So you see minus K1, 0, 0, minus K2. So this is a feature of this stiffness matrix. So if I summarize the step, after discretizing, creating a mesh, we did write the element stiffness equations or matrices for each element. We were able to assemble the global stiffness equations that ensure continuity as well as equilibrium of the nodes. And now we are ready, when we apply boundary condition, we can use the global stiffness equations to solve for the unknowns. And usually the unknowns would be nodal displacements and unknown external forces or force reactions. We use the nodal displacements, the one we calculate, to solve for unknown support reactions. So first we may need to eliminate some of the equations and first solve when we apply boundary condition. Like, should I know that U1 is a zero, for example, then I can simply eliminate the first row and solve for U2 and U3. Once I have U2 and U3, I can come back and solve for F1, which in this case could be the unknown support reaction. Once I have solved for the degrees of freedom or nodal displacement, I can come back and use the nodal displacement and the element stiffness equations to solve for the nodal internal forces. So I can use them to solve for the element or nodal internal forces per the element. And in doing so, we are finding the results that we are interested in, whether it's displacements or internal forces, stress or strain. Quick review here of this introduction. I want to mention the vocabulary that we use. We learned about the finite element method, elements, nodes, mesh. This is an elastic system, degrees of freedom, numerical solution, algebraic equations. Polynomial functions are the one that we use to interpolate to find displacement between the nodes. Now, I'm not going to expect you to do this by hands, but this is how the ANSYS does it, by using these shape functions or polynomial function. Stiffness matrix is that square matrix that describes the relationship between the action and the effect. Global stiffness matrix is that uppercase KG that relates the external forces to the displacements at degrees of freedom of the entire structure. You've already learned about determinate structure and indeterminate structure. Determinate is the one that we can solve simply by using equations of equilibrium. Indeterminate is the one that we need additional equation to solve for. And I want to take this opportunity to mention that the finite element method may be used for both determinate and indeterminate problems without asking you for more equations. Please remember again, determinate problems are the one that has number of unknowns equal to the number of equations of equilibrium. So we simply use equations of equilibrium. Indeterminate, when I have more unknowns, I have redundancies. So I have more unknowns than the number of equations of equilibrium. For the indeterminate problems, we needed more equations and we use compatibility equations. When I'm using the finite element method, the good news is I don't have to worry about more compatibility because the global stiffness equations already are ensuring continuity. Okay. One important thing I mentioned here, stiffness or spring constant, or when we looked at the bar element, we looked at this K equals to EA over L, where A and L are properties of the element, the area of the bar and the length of the bar. However, E is a material property. And this would tell me that in order to use the stiffness method, I need to have the material property E at least. So this is, we always have, like when we use statics to solve problems, we never had to provide you material properties if it's a determinate problem. When we're using the stiffness equations or the finite element method, even if it's a determinate problem, we're gonna need to use the material property E. We learned also about element stiffness equations and global stiffness equations, GSE. I think with this, we kind of walked over the important concept of the finite element method. I showed you how to assemble global stiffness equations using element stiffness equation for two elements, spring elements connected together. And I think it is time to do an example. Our class meeting is up for now because it's 9:30. And I know some of you may have other commitments, but I am gonna do is I'm gonna, you already have, by the way, on the Canvas, an example that builds upon, you'll find this on Canvas, two connected elements. This is very similar to what I just covered in class here, showing how we ensure the continuity and assemble global stiffness equations. And then it takes this to an example that you have seen in solid mechanics of two members connected together. And I start by solving this using the classical method where I find that this is an indeterminate problem and we need compatibility equations to solve for all the unknowns. So I write one equation of equilibrium. I come up with a compatibility equation. So solve for the support reactions and then the internal forces in the members. Then I use finite element method to solve the same problem by expressing the spring constant for each of these bars or elements. And I use the global stiffness equations as we put it together today in class. So I'm also gonna post a video to walk you through this to allow you to use the same concept or principle to solve homework number 5, which is due